I just spent 45 minutes talking about autoencoders just to realize that, of course, the whole video was out of focus. So guess what? I have to do it all over again. But you know what? It doesn't matter. I'm gonna do it again because autoencoders deserve it. It's one of my favorite techniques. It's smart, it's clever, and it's super intuitive. So let's take a look at them and let's see if you can get away from this video with something else for you to do. So let's start with one specific example. This is a hypothetical world where you spend your life taking pictures of sharks, and over the years, you have accumulated a beautiful, awesome, incredible data set of hundreds of thousands of pictures of sharks. And guess what? National Geographic wants to buy that data set from you, and they will pay millions of dollars because it's unique, it's awesome, it's amazing. There is one catch, however. They will knock down $10,000 for every image in that data set that is not a shark. So you don't want to make any mistakes or your profits are going to go down. So what do? If you are like me, you definitely don't have the time to go through 100,000 images. So you are going to have to find a way to automate this process. Idea number one, you want to build a binary classification problem that looks at all of the pictures and learns what a shark is and what is not a shark and classifies them and get over with it. There are a few problems with a binary classifier. The first problem is that you are going to spend time labeling data, and you don't want to spend any time. You're gonna have to go to your data set and start labeling shark, not shark, not good. It will take a long time to do that. Problem number two, this is going to make for a very, very imbalanced data set because you're gonna have many pictures of sharks and not too many pictures of non-sharks. But there is an even bigger problem, and that's problem number three. This is what we think a binary classifier is going to do. Given a picture, we're gonna ask whether it's a shark or it isn't, and then make a decision based on that. But that is not what a binary classification model will do. Instead, this is what a binary classification model will do. Given a picture, we are gonna compare it with a bunch of pictures of sharks and compare it with a bunch of pictures of other stuff. And the binary classifier will decide in which of these two buckets it should put this picture. So it will basically decide whether this picture looks more like a shark or looks more like a shrimp or a fish or a crab or whatever it is in this bucket. That means that if we have a picture of a truck and that truck happens to look more like a shark than a shrimp, then the binary classifier will tell us that the truck is a shark. And that is a huge problem. Here is the thing. What we are facing is what we call an anomaly detection problem. And we should not try to tackle an anomaly detection problem with a binary classifier. There are better ways to do that. Think about the words anomaly detection. We want to detect anything that is not like normal, which in our case is a shark. So autoencoders are the perfect way to tackle some of these problems. So let's take a look at the structure of an autoencoder and let's build some insight into how they work. So I put this together. It's a quick representation of an autoencoder, and I want you to take a look at three sections here. The first section is the encoder portion, the second section is a bottleneck, and the third section is the decoder portion. Now let's focus first on the first two sections. Let's build some intuition into how they work and why they are designed this way. I want you to think of an autoencoder as a compression algorithm first. We want to take a concept on one side and we want to summarize, we want to compress that concept down in a way where we strip away any details that are not important. Here is one example. Here are four pictures of a shark. Very different pictures, all of them. The color of the water is different. This one here shows like maybe sand or whatever it is at the bottom of the ocean. You know, this shark is kind of like aggressive. Very different pictures. Here is an experiment for you. I want you to talk to any of your friends and show your friend all of these pictures. And I want you to ask them to summarize each one of these pictures using a single word. And I bet you every one of them will say shark. That is something amazing that humans do. They're capable of taking complex concepts, stripping away everything that doesn't matter, and boiling down to the essence of what the picture represents. And that is precisely what we want our autoencoder to do. We want it to take these complex ideas and compress them down into what we call an intermediate representation. So if we go back to our representation of an autoencoder, through these three layers here, the encoder and the bottleneck, we are forcing the network to compress whatever the input is down to the size of the bottleneck. That is a crucial decision on the design of an autoencoder. The bottleneck forces the network to compress. If we have 1,000 input elements and we have a bottleneck of 500 elements, we are forcing the network to represent 1,000 things into only 500 values. We're cutting down the size of the input in half. That is the idea here. That's exactly what people are doing here. They're taking all of these pixels and notions and colors and shapes and texture, and they're removing all of that. They're stripping away anything that doesn't represent the essence of the concept, and they are telling you the word shark as the compressed representation of the idea. So if our autoencoder is working well, our autoencoder will do precisely that through these first section of the autoencoder, the encoding part and the bottleneck. But there is another section, which is the decoder. So why do we need that? Well, we want to ensure somehow that the encoder portion of the autoencoder is actually doing a good job. And the final representation, or that intermediate representation, is actually representing the concept that we care about. So the way we do that is by reversing this portion right here. So you're gonna notice it's the same shape, just in reverse here. We want to go from the bottleneck, from that summarized, compressed representation, to the original input. What does that mean? Well, the way we train an autoencoder is by taking one image, in our case, an image of a shark, passing it through the input layers, compressing it down to the bottleneck, and then having this portion here decompress that image, and we are going to compare the output to the original image. And the way we're gonna train this network is by using the reconstruction error. The reconstruction error, it's basically the difference between two images, the input image and the reconstructed image that our autoencoder is going to output. The closer those two images are, the lower the error is going to be. The farther apart those images are, the larger the error. Now, how does this help? Let's imagine that we train our autoencoder with hundreds of thousands of pictures of sharks. So what the autoencoder will have to do is to learn what's common across all of those pictures. Like, what are the actual features that represent a shark? And it's gonna have to condense those instructions in the bottleneck. And those instructions will allow the autoencoder to later reproduce that image. So it's going to write down on the bottleneck, you know what, we need to represent the water, and the water is going to be this color, right? This is the way we human beings think of what the autoencoder is doing. It's just a set of instructions on how to take that summarized representation and turn it back into the original image. But as soon as the autoencoder sees something that is not a shark, unfortunately, the instructions are not gonna give us a good output. If we show the autoencoder a picture of a truck, what we're gonna get on the other side, it's something that's gonna look like a shark, because that's what the autoencoder has been trained to do. So imagine we have this beautiful vintage truck, and it's part of our data set, and the autoencoder sees it, and goes through the bottleneck, and the bottleneck has the instructions to, starting from here, construct the picture of a shark. That's what the autoencoder knows. We're probably gonna get something stupid like this, which is kind of a track, but it's also a shark. By the way, I generated this picture using DALL-E 2, which is amazing. So when we try to compute the reconstruction error between this vintage truck and this thing, the error is gonna be really, really large compared to the error of giving the autoencoder a picture of a shark and getting a picture of a shark on the other side. So how high or low this threshold has to be, well, we're gonna have to learn what that looks like. But that is precisely how we will use an autoencoder to solve our problem. We're gonna train it with 100,000 images of sharks and things. Fortunately for us, most pictures are sharks. So the autoencoder will learn to discard any details that do not represent the shark. So even if we have shrimp and octopus and other fish inside our data set, the autoencoder will push those away, will not learn those characteristics because they are not what's common across all of that data set. So at the time that we're ready to use our system, if there is a picture of an octopus, the autoencoder will try to create a shark on the other side. That's what it knows. So as soon as we compare a picture of a sharky octopus with this picture, the error, the reconstruction error, is gonna be really, really high, and we are going to know that this picture is not a picture of a shark. Now, that's great, but that's not the only useful thing that we can do with autoencoders. I'm gonna give you one quick example before finishing this video, and it's how to use autoencoder to denoise, remove noise from pictures. That sounds useful, right? So here's something I put together really, really quick, and it's based on a Keras example that you can find online, the source code, the whole thing, on how to use the MNIST dataset of handwritten digits to remove noise from images. So the way this works is just, there is a tweak on the way we train the autoencoder. We have the autoencoder here, and we have the encoder portion, we have the bottleneck, and we have the decoder portion. Here, I'm gonna be providing images with noise. So in this case, I'm showing the autoencoder a picture of a number 4, and there is a lot of noise added to that picture. And I'm going to compare the output with the original picture of a 4. So notice the difference. Here, I'm not using the same picture as the input and as the output. I'm using a picture with noise as the input and the clean picture as the output, forcing the autoencoder to, whatever it does, as part of the encoder process, it forces the autoencoder to learn a clean representation of that picture. Because if there is a lot of noise here, then the reconstruction error is gonna be high. And what's really, really cool is that when you do this, when you run this example, you are going to see, you're gonna pass images with noise, and the output is going to be an image without noise. So it will learn how to denoise pictures that look like the pictures that you train the autoencoder on. Now, there are more useful applications for autoencoders. There are also different ways to design an autoencoder that do not require a bottleneck, but those are gonna be for a different conversation. For now, my recommendation to you is to take a look at the denoising example. You're gonna be able to find the source code. Try to practice autoencoders in some way, and I'm sure you're gonna find plenty of areas where the same ideas of autoencoders you will be able to apply and you will benefit from. For now, I'm done for today, and I'll see you next week.